Praise the Lord. Would you open your Bibles this morning to the Gospel of John, chapter 8, looking at verse 2, starting at verse 2. A familiar section of Scripture that is often preached, talked, encouraged, instructed, used for correction, instruction, used in a variety of ways to help people to understand the mercy of the Lord, to understand their situation before God. And as we read through, of course, it will be familiar to you as well. Looking at John chapter 8, looking at verse 2, beginning at verse 2, going to verse 11, it says, "Now early in the morning, he came again into the temple, and all the people came to him, and he sat down and taught them. Then the scribes and Pharisees brought to him a woman caught in adultery. And when they had set her in the midst, they said to him, 'Teacher, this woman was caught in adultery, in the very act. Now Moses in the law commanded us that such should be stoned. But what do you say?' This they said, testing him, that they might have something of which to accuse him. But Jesus stooped down and wrote on the ground with his finger, as though he did not hear. So when they continued asking him, he raised himself up and said to them, 'He who is without sin among you, let him throw a stone at her first.' And again he stooped down and wrote on the ground. Then those who heard it, being convicted by their conscience, went out one by one, beginning with the oldest even to the last, and Jesus was left alone and the woman standing in the midst. When Jesus had raised himself up and saw no one but the woman, he said to her, 'Woman, where are those accusers of yours? Has no one condemned you?' She said, 'No one, Lord.' And Jesus said to her, 'Neither do I condemn you. Go and sin no more.'" Yes. Tremendous section of Scripture, is it not? I call it one woman's moment before Christ. One woman's moment before Christ. Here we are at the end of the Lord's ministry on earth. He's coming to the end. He's coming to the time where he's going to say, "It is finished." He's on his way to Calvary. He knows he is. He knows all that's being arranged around him. He knows all the scoffers are and the schemers are plotting against him. He knows that. He knows it's time that he's going to be forsaken by the Father. He knows that. The Pharisees are out to kill him. And they're out to kill Lazarus as well. They're plotting to kill both of them. They're drawing closer moment by moment. Every moment that goes by, every second that goes by, he's one step closer to his time on the cross. One more step closer where he says, "I glorify you, Father." As he's in Gethsemane, and as he's being rejected, and as he's going to the cross, "Glorify, Lord, glorify, I glorify you." On the cross, by the way of the cross, he glorified the Father. We ask ourselves and say, "Well, how can we glorify God?" "Well, I give you glory. I just sang to you." This is the glory of the Lord, is the crucifixion. To pick up your cross and to deny yourself. That is the glory. That's how you glorify the Father, where the divine nature comes alive in you, and you live and walk in the Spirit, and you pick up your cross, and with joy you carry out his commandments for the joy that is set before you. This is the glory of the Lord in your life. Here he is with his disciples, still milling about Jerusalem, teaching, guiding, correcting, and Judas is getting prepared to betray him. He knows that. Pharisees are plotting to kill him. Scoffers and scorners are huffing and puffing. Oh, the huffy puffy spirit. Over my years in ministry, I've oftentimes seen the huffy puffy. Oh, oh, I can't stand it. Have you seen it? Have you seen it in the mirror? Oh, the huffy puffy. And oh, they look like a cat in an alley sniffing out something. You know, it's like, oh, goodness, as though that moves the Lord, as though that's your great torment. It's, well, these guys are all plotting against him with their scoffs and their schemes and their deceiving and their mocking and all of it is, and he's headed towards the cross. His beard's going to be pulled out. Here he is. All this is coming. This is right in front of him. All of it is right in front of him. And they're looking for a reason to turn the people against Christ. That's what they're doing. They're looking for a reason. has that not even happened in right here? Looking for a reason to turn against, hold something against. Yeah, he said, yeah, she said, yeah, they said, yeah, you said. And there's always those who are looking for the reason that they don't have to surrender to Christ. There's always those who will look for a reason that they don't have to yield to, listen to. I don't have to listen to you. I don't have to. You're not the, oh, what is that two-year-old, three-year-old phrase? You're not the boss of me. Basically what they're saying in their three, four-year-old approach, throwing a little temper tantrum. They're looking for a reason to despise him. They're looking for a reason to catch him in falsehood and blasphemy. They're looking for a reason to kill him. They're looking for a reason to kill him. They're looking for a reason to stone him. They're looking for a reason to do away with him. They're looking for a reason to turn the people away from him. They're looking for the Christ to be diminished in some way, that his attractors become detractors. You'll find that still in life today. This isn't just John chapter 8. Oh, that's happened then. This is still going on today. To turn attractors into detractors. Well, I don't know. It oftentimes just begins with that little thought or that little word that came to your ear, that little thing that you didn't like, that little thing that came against your personal affection that you like, your personal plan that you've been devising and don't want anybody to know just yet. You haven't yet got the courage and the brass to just walk out or say or do what you want. I saw a gal one time in church here who was frustrated for a couple of years. Till finally she got up the nerve to be able, by her counselor, said, you need to start speaking your mind. And her counselor told her that you need to go see that pastor and tell him. So here she is right at the pulpit and uses a swear word against me. And I'm gonna speak my mind, and uses a swear word. And of course, the next week they weren't here. And we find that that's still going on today. I need a reason in order to be a detractor rather than an attractor. And they're looking to diminish the role of Christ in their lives, to diminish the role of Christ, to diminish the cross. That, you mean I can get to heaven and not really have that much of this cross in my life? Even though I've sung, I surrender all, I still struggle with actually doing that. Here he's in the midst of all of this going on, and they're looking for a way to diminish his influence. They're looking for a reason to kill him. And here it is. John chapter 8. Here it is. They've caught her in the very act. And in other words, somebody's getting stoned today. Somebody. This woman is going to get stoned, or he's going to get stoned. I've set up my snare. I've set up my trap. We've caught him in the very act. And here we are. It's the aha moment. The glee that comes to the person's eye where we finally caught him. The aha, we've got him. Aha. Have you ever seen somebody feel like they've got you? You've seen maybe movies or shows, and they've got times where the person, the accuser, the scoffer, the schemer, the deceiver, the one who's been plotting, the one who's been envious against, and they finally feel that they've got you in this aha moment. It's the Esau or Edomite mentality towards the Israelites. When Jerusalem was getting razed by the enemy, when they were getting destroyed by the enemy, and the Edomites were there, and they were saying, aha. Aha, finally they're getting theirs. Finally they're getting, yeah, finally that pastor's being taken down a few notches. Oh, the people have been wanting to take me down a couple of notches. Who does he think he is? I know exactly who I am. But they, their own pride have taken him down. And that's what they're trying to do right here. Take him down. It's the aha, take him down. Who does he think he is being the judge over us? Who does he think he is being the righteous one among us and always teaching us and telling us what to do and instructing and correcting and guiding? And he's taking, everybody's following him instead of us. Oh, now we discovered the real problem. I remember someone getting irritated with me standing right there. Right there, everybody had left. We're heading over to Teen Challenge and to Happy Family to bring the Teen Challenge crew out. Comes up to me and all full, huffy puffy, all puffed up, all huffy puffy. So you're destroying everything I'm doing. They called me pastor, and all, what's the word? Huffy puffy. They said all puffy puffy and like this and snarly look, and That's what's going on. That's what they're doing right here. Because see, what Jesus said just before in the chapter, in the teaching, just before, chapter 7, verse 19, he says this. Jesus said this. Did not Moses give you the law? Yet none of you keeps the law. Why do you seek to kill me? See that right there? Look at chapter 7, verse 19 right there. Did not Moses give you the law? Now what are they doing here with this adulterous woman? Bringing in the law. Here. Right here. See, we're doing the law. We're doing the law. We're ready. Have you ever had people who are zealous to destroy somebody else? Like, here, they're ready to stone this woman and uphold the law. And they say, he, out of your own words, you said, out of your own words, Jesus, you said this. Did not Moses give the law? Yet none of you keeps the law. Well, yeah, we keep the law. Look, here's this woman. We caught her in the very act. What do you say? What do you say? And he doesn't answer them, right? So what do? They pester him. They keep asking and asking as though, aha, he doesn't know how to answer us. Aha, he doesn't know what to say. Aha, we got him. Aha, aha. But love always knows what to do. Love always knows what to do. He's waiting for them to unfold their pestering ways. They're after an answer. And she's caught. There's no doubt about it. She's caught. Adultery. A life of betrayal. Adultery is a life of betrayal. It's one of disloyalty. Remember what Jesus said? That even if you think it, even if it comes to your mind, you're already there in the human nature. You're already there in the unfaithful, disloyal nature. You're already there in the flesh nature. Just thinking it. Even the idea of bringing it to question, even bringing it to mind, saying, well, if I do this, is it adultery? You're already there. You've already accomplished it. You're already in the human nature, disloyal. You're entertaining it. Nasty, nasty business. A person can't be trusted if they have an adulterous mind. They can't be trusted. You can't trust their word. During World War II, what is the one thing that spies were always looking for to try to find those loose lips? Or if they found somebody, as a matter of fact, if they were choosing spies, like if England was choosing spies, they wanted a person who was loyal and not given to a certain sin of adultery, because that one could easily be succumb and spill the secrets. They couldn't be trusted. Here we find that the adulterous mind is double-minded and double-hearted. Doesn't have resolve to stay true to their own word. Looking and casting eyes elsewhere all the time. Her mind and her life is one of adultery. Jesus confirms it. They judged rightly. Did they judge rightly? Absolutely. Does the law call for destruction? Yes. By stoning? Yes. All true. One moment she's lying down in comfort and pleasure. And the next moment she's dragged out into the crowd, through the crowd, and set in the midst of the judge, Christ Jesus himself. Dragged through the crowd and under the public eye of scrutiny, dragged out of that place of comfort and pleasure, and how many times she's been there, drags that person out, that adulterous woman out, and puts her in the midst, through the public eye, through the public square. Imagine all the men's tongues wagging. Imagine all the plotting and the glee and the excitement of that's hitting the area, that all of a sudden it's like, man, we're going to see something today. And they're looking for it. They want it to happen. They've got this woman. They've caught her. They've got her in the eyes of Jesus. And now she's right front in the eyes of the Lord. There she is. And it can't be denied. Imagine the fear in her eyes. Whereas just before her eyes were closed, and all of a sudden here she is. Imagine the fear in her eyes. This could be her last day. Imagine that first stone hitting you. These weren't like little stones that the kids throw in these little three-quarter pebbles that we find for landscaping. Picked up a stone. You get hit with that, you're going to know it. And there's a zeal in wanting to do it. To see it happen. to let self-righteousness have a little time of gloating as though, yeah, see, that's not us. See, we're not doing that. The excitement in the air, the big wagging tongues going on, the trembling moments clicking by, her eyes wide, wondering, shame is, here she is dragged before everybody, shame, I'm caught, I'm an adulteress. I'm a disloyal, unfaithful woman, and I'm caught. I'm stuck, and here I am. She's dragged from the side of one woman, one man, and put in front of another. Moses called for stoning. She's trapped. She's got no place to go. She can't run from the crowd. She can't run from the eyes of the Lord. She can't run from the trap that's been set. And notice, she's just the pawn. She's the catalyst, right? They're not against her. I mean, they are for her sin, but they're actually looking to trap Christ. That's the, it's nothing, it has nothing to do with her. It has to do who are you for and against? They're against Christ, and they're using her to display and demonstrate it. It's, keep in mind, it's always about Christ. It's always about the Holy Spirit. It's always about heaven. It's always about the kingdom. It's always about coming against His cross. It's always coming against His Spirit. People would like to say that they're against me. They're not against me. They're against the Holy Spirit. They're against the Word of God coming alive in earth. They're against the cross, trying to hang on some semblance of self. They wanted to see Jesus speak against the law. They wanted to set Him up and be the fault finders. They're waiting for Him to speak against the law or uphold the law, which thus proves that they are doing the law. Do you see the self-righteousness involved? See, we're doing the law. You said we don't do the law, but we did. See what we're doing? So in their self-righteousness, they're looking to prove themselves that they're doing the law, thus saying that what He said earlier is a lie. See what I mean? See, what you said earlier, did Moses give you the law? But none of you keeps the law. See, we're doing it, so you're a liar. What you said is not true. Got you. Aha. Or you defend the woman, or you come again, and now we caught you in blasphemy. So either way, we've set the trap. And it's a good trap. But the one thing they're not counting on is the Holy Spirit. Right? The one thing they're not counting on is the Holy Spirit. That's your solace. That's your security. Your solace and your security is always the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit. The majority vote of one. Where He comes in. You trust Him for the outcome. As the Bible says in Psalms, offer the sacrifices of righteousness and put your trust in the Lord. Do the right thing unto the Lord. Let the outcome be in His hands. They continued to question Him. Pester Him. Anybody ever been pestered? Anybody have children? True. Pestering. Remember Jesus said about the evil judge coming and the woman pestering, calling upon? Pestering. I want an answer. They are so secure in their trap. They are so secure in their snare. They've set the trap. They're so secure that they've got Him finally, that either they're going to prove themselves that they do the law and He's a liar, or that he's going to speak against the law and against Moses, thus proving that what they said about Him is true. Either way, they're trying to make it about them and validate and justify themselves. So they continue to question Him. He didn't respond. They pester Him. He didn't respond. Somebody's going to get a rock in the face today. Him or her? Which one? What's going to happen here? If He says guilty and agrees with the law, she's dead. If He says not guilty, He's dead. He's the one. But it's kind of an anticlimactic ending for them all. They're filled with excitement and they're ready to throw stones. The whole place is heated up and they're ready. You've got to picture yourself there. This really took place. Imagine yourself. Now, you'd like to probably think that you're right there next to Jesus. Like, what are you going to do? But we're probably the guy with the stone. They're right there. Or were the adulterers that was dragged out. And you must see yourself there. I must see myself, the one who was the adulterer, not loyal, not faithful. You got to see yourself who loves the world. You got to see yourself. Oh, I would the guy that throw the stone. No, you're the adulterer that's been dragged before the court. I'm the adulteress. I'm the one with the bad mind, bad heart, disloyal, unfaithful, could care less, and just serving my own pleasures and my own ends and with another woman's man. Yep, that's me. It's an anticlimactic ending as we see it come to an end, though. Jesus said to the crowd in John chapter 8, verse 7, "He who is without sin among you, let him throw a stone at her first." Quite a statement, is it not? He's trusting the Holy Spirit. He knows the Holy Spirit's there. He's trusting the Holy Spirit's convicting power. See, when you don't know what to do, love always knows what to do. And he puts his trust, he puts his full faith and trust in the Holy Spirit. The one who led him in the wilderness, remember, to test him? Is the same one right here who's going to convict the crowd. How many thoughts did the Holy Spirit flood their minds with in that moment? The minute he said, "He who is without sin, let him throw a stone at her first." The minute that happened, the Holy Spirit starts convicting. How many thoughts went through their mind? Just before in our praise time, didn't Pastor Adam say, think on the Lord's goodness in our life. In 60 seconds, where did your mind go? And what are the things that you thought of on the goodness of the Lord? Well, let's flip that to John chapter 8. And think about all the adulterous ways and all the sinful ways and all the foolish ways and all the criminal ways and all the deception and all the things that they thought and said and did as the Holy Spirit comes in and starts squeezing them, that all that sinful thinking, human nature, life pops to the surface and starts flooding their mind. And it's like, oh my goodness, that's me. That's where we all must go. You kind of come to that place where it's, that's me. That's me. I did that. I remember my time before the Lord. All right, let me change that. I remember my times before the Lord convicting, bringing me to that place of showing me, basically, thou art the man. You're the one. You did. That's what you are. The places where you thought that you were good and did right and validated and justified, where pride was supreme in your life, where you chose your own plans and chose your own ways and went your own and justified and validated and made it even spiritual till the Holy Spirit comes in and squeezes. And without the squeeze, that convicting power of the Holy Spirit, and he leaves you to your own mind and your own ways, and you walk around as though you're the one who's always right. And no, I see clearly till he shows you. Without his mind, you're not seeing clearly at all. What sins came to the surface and pricked their conscience? What shame flooded their hearts under the Holy Spirit's pressure of his mighty hand? From the oldest to the youngest, they started leaving. Yes? From the oldest to the youngest. I always thought that was interesting. Like, why at the oldest? And I figured, those are the guys with the most sins. Those are the guys they're the ones who can, let's go back over 70 years. Oh my goodness. And you got the youngest saying, well, all I've done is, right? But they're all sinful. But the oldest has got the longest record. The oldest has got the longest record. I know when the Lord came into my life at 34, I look and say, I wish he would have come into my life at 14. Wish he would have come into my life at 4, saved me a host of problems. But that became my testimony. That became your testimony. Let it never be a testimony of waywardness, that I came to the Lord and then I walked wayward. I came to the Lord and I knew his truth, but I wanted my own. Never let that be. That's not a testimony of the goodness of God, the grace of God, the mercy of God, the power of God. Come into this place where you realize that, wait a minute, Jesus is working in right here, right now, the Holy Spirit. He said, he who is without sin, he's not saying she did wrong. He's confirming it. But he's relying on the Holy Spirit's conviction to come in. When he said, he who is without sin, he didn't rebuke the crowd. Did he say, you're not loving? Did he say that? You're not a loving church. You're not a, there's not loving of you. You should all just love and forgive her. Just forget it. Did he do that?
No.
He didn't do that. He justifies. He says, no, that's true. She is. That's exactly what she is. He confirmed her sinfulness. Let one without sin cast the first stone. Please hear me now. In that entire crowd, in that entire scenario, who's the only one who could actually throw the stone?
Jesus.
He could have whacked her with that stone right then and there, justifying, proving, I'm the only one who can actually do this. Adulterer. Absolutely. Justify the law, fulfill the law. But what's the Bible say? All the law is fulfilled in
love.
All the law. Jesus said, I came to fulfill the law and the prophets. Come into this place where instead he relies on the Holy Spirit to convict them. He's not bringing in a condemnation and a conviction to destroy her, but to give her an opportunity to be saved. This is the age of grace. Wrath is coming. The age of wrath is coming, no doubt. But in this age of mercy and grace, in this age of repentance, in this age of where we can turn to the Lord, we're in this age where he's calling every man to repent. Is that not what the Bible says? This is the age where in time past he forgave, but in now he's looking and saying, now it's everyone repent. That's why he tells her what? Sin no more. Where are your accusers? Do you see them? None, Lord. What word did she use to describe him? Lord. None, Lord. Who was the thief on the cross? Lord. Anyone who calls upon the name of the Lord? Submitting and surrendering. Here she is, this adulterous woman, and says, Lord, Lord. Power, yes?
Yes.
Come into this place where this adulterous woman says, none. She doesn't go, none. You know the attitude? None. As though I'm justified in myself, as though, well, you don't know what I've been through in my life. You don't know what I was brought up under. She didn't come up with that. None. Lord. It always begins with what word?
Lord.
Submitting and surrendering to the Lord. Come into that place that whoever calls upon the name of the Lord, whoever confesses with their mouth, the Lord Jesus, Lord, none, Lord, no one's here. And then he says, I don't either. My language. I'm not here to condemn you either. But he didn't leave it there, did he? Wouldn't we love it to just leave those last three words off? He didn't leave those last three words off. He emphasized them. He didn't leave them off. He emphasized them. And said what? Sin no more. In other words, repent. Turn away from, turn to the living God. Put off the old life, put on the new life. Come into that place of the repentant life. Sin no more. As a matter of fact, I think it's in John chapter 5:14. Let me confirm. When Jesus spoke to another person and said, afterward, Jesus found him in the temple and said to him, see, you have been made well. Then he says these three words. You already know them, which is what? Sin no more. And then he adds this, lest a worse thing come upon you. Lest a worst thing come upon you. Sin no more. And the story ends, yes?
Yeah.
We don't know. How did it pan out for her? What did Monday look like? What happened at the next temptation? What happened at the next opportunity? What happened at the next decision? What happened to the community of people she used to hang around with? What happened when the men she used to hang around with start calling? What happened to the family who always knew her a certain way? What happened to? Her value system, her identity, her pleasures. What happened to it all? Sin no more. Do not be like you used to. Be the new. Be like me. Be like the children of God. Be in holiness. A holy calling deserves a holy walk. Going after the things of God. Seeing these things developing in her life, that all this has just been, her next day has completely been disrupted. Just like she was dragged out of that house and by the side of a man and put in front of Christ, now threatened to be stoned, eyes wide, trembling, wondering how this is all going to... She has no idea how this is going to unfold. All she's about to see is stones coming her way. And Jesus, in his quiet way, hardly says anything. Tick, 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 wondering. All of a sudden he speaks to the crowd, the one without sin. You be the first one to cast. She's waiting for it. She doesn't know the verses that we know. In that heat of that moment, she's just standing there wondering how this is going to unfold. Waiting for that first rock to come. And it only takes the one, doesn't it? And the rest would have been unleashed. One, two, three, four, five stones coming her way. And the sixth one goes, No, I probably have a little sin. No, once it's unleashed, it's unleashed. But the Holy Spirit convicts. Leave the old behind. Sin no more. Decision time. Now what? I speak to you and I speak to me. God Almighty came into our life and moved us out of the adulterous situation and brought us to his side and said the same thing to us. Forgiven. No condemnation. Paul made it clear in Romans, no condemnation. Those who are in Christ Jesus. Jesus then says what? Sin no more. Now the battle begins, does it not? I have battles today in my own heart, mind, and soul that I didn't have for the first 34 years of my life. But when the Holy Spirit came in and started battling, you've got to let him win. That sinful life, sinful thinking, adulterous ways has to go. It's time for the repentant life to hear him. To obey him, to trust him, to go after the things of God, to want the cloud of witnesses, to seek after the heavenly throne, to, what's it in chapter 12, 1 and 2, as we just covered, let us lay aside that weight, let us lay aside that sin that so easily ensnares, let us with endurance run our course, run our race, go after, looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith. That's the same thing. He could have said the same thing here. Sin no more. Well, this all begins when the Holy Spirit comes and speaks and convicts you of your adulterous ways. This isn't about just being the person who's, well, I've never committed adultery, so this doesn't apply to me. Well, no, I've always been faithful in my marriage, but... When James wrote clearly in James chapter 4, did he not? Adulterers and adulteresses, he's writing to the church. Adulterers and adulteresses, he who makes a friend of the world makes himself an enemy of God. Oh, well then maybe. All right? Right? As the conviction of the Holy Spirit comes and say, thou art the man. It's you. You love your personal affections and your personal sin, and you excuse and explain yourself, and you go by your own counsel and your own words, and you massage the scriptures to have your own way, and yeah, because you love the things of the world, you love all the things that it's offering, and you want just so much of Jesus that you can get to heaven, but you really do like, and you have the world hasn't grown strangely dim, and now you're being pulled alongside of Jesus, and he's saying what to you and I? Sin no more. Don't have that double mind. Don't have that double heart. Don't have that double tongue. Leave the old behind and come to the new, because we're in the age of mercy. We're in the age of grace, where God is calling for, let every man repent. Let every person repent. You look and say, what did her life look like? What did it look like the next day? What did it look like over the years unfolding? What did it look like when she sees Christ on the cross? What does it look like? What did her life, no one doesn't say. We don't know how it all unfolds. All we know is that he's calling for us to be loyal and faithful. What was the charge against Judah and Jerusalem in the days of Jeremiah? You have forsaken the Lord thy God. You've gone after your own cisterns. You've gone after the false gods. You've gone after your own ways. You've put your trust in man and not the Word of God. And you have forsaken, you have forsaken, you shook off the ways of the Lord. Disloyal, unfaithful. Hard words, and we say, no, God's all, it's all love. Like, why didn't he just turn to the girl and say, I love you, gal. You're just as great. You're just caught in a bad time, and I know the lifestyle you had and things that took place, and your mom did this and your dad said that, and that friend left you, and I know that you're weak. I know you're weak, and just, just go along your way and try your best and remember that no one stoned you today, okay? Oh, that's today's gospel message. Today's gospel message is, come on here, hon. Come on, hon. Keep trying. No one's here. I protected you. You're all good. You're all set. No harm done. Keep trying your best. And next time you feel tempted, just try not to, okay? And if you do, just come see me again. No, what'd he say?
Sin no more.
Sin no more. That's me too. But I'm the pastor and I'm excused a certain amount of leeway because of the stress I'm under. Yeah, right. Yeah. That's the other two words. Yeah, right. Yeah. Right? So that we can have a little bit more leeway out there. But James once again says what? Let not many of you be called teacher. Greater judgment. But today, I tell you, that's what's going on in the pastoral world. Is that since I'm under stress and since I'm a pastor, and that since this is going on, I need my getaway time. Well, I don't do adultery. I mean, I just spend my day on video games. Oh, you fit just fine. You fit just fine. Pastors out there teaching and preaching that it's okay for this and okay for that, to entertain yourself with this way and that way. Oh, I'm telling the truth. Because it's all okay, because at least God's love is for you. When he said to the adulterous woman caught in a snare, sin no more. Adulteresses and adulteresses, he said. Do you not know that friendship with the world is enmity with God? Whoever therefore wants to be a friend of the world makes himself an enemy of God. Or do you think that the scripture says in vain, the spirit who dwells in us yearns jealousy? Jealously. He's a jealous God. No, God is not jealous. Oh, it says he's a jealous God. He's a jealous God. He's for me and he's not out to share me with everybody else. He's looking for what kind of bride? A pure and spotless bride. He's not looking for me to be the adulteress out there, going my own way with the world, doing what I want, my own ways, please myself, my own affections, my own attractions, claim the love of God, claim the grace of God, claim the mercy of God, get to heaven and realize I missed it. I missed it. I played the adulterer the whole time. The Bible says in 1 John chapter 3, I think it's verse 3, that whoever has this hope purifies himself just as he is pure. You and I have come to this place where we want to be servants of the Lord, yes? That the only one who had the right to throw the stone was Christ himself, and instead he forgave. It's the age of mercy. I've given Jesus plenty of reasons to throw a stone. Unsaved, my unsaved days and my saved days. 34 years, not saved, not living for the Lord. But I realized the Lord had been with me. 32 years now, serving the Lord as of October. As a pastor, as a teacher, as his ambassador, to bring forth his message. And in those both sections of time, I've given the Lord plenty of reason to be the one who stones me under the law. But in this age of grace, he continually tells me to what? Sin no more. Let it go. Put on the new. What has been my quest? What has been your quest? What is our quest? What should we be encouraging each other with? but to sin no more, to move on with the new, to get the holy boldness, to get that, as we preached last time, a bold love, to get that holy boldness, that love to not cower under the hand of the scrutinous law, but instead to give yourself over to the Lord, and traps will be set as they set here, the snare and the sin that so easily ensnares us. And he could have easily have just said, that's right, and whacked her. But he didn't. He says, no one is here to condemn you, and neither do I condemn you. Let me end it this way. When she saw him the second time, wonder what that meeting was like. Well, it's not in Scripture the second time that they don't meet up again. Yeah, they do. It's way back here in Revelation, where all of a sudden you find that Jesus is going to bring everyone and see everyone, and the eyes of fire will go over all. And everyone, what's it say in Corinthians? Everyone will give an account for the things that were done. Did you do what I said? Those three words, little girl. Little girl, did you hear? Woman, did you hear? Adulterous woman, did you sin no more? Did you go? Did you follow? Did you listen? Did you learn? Did you trust? Did you obey? You and I, we don't know that. It doesn't tell the rest of the story. It ends right there. But do you know how he ends it? Go to the very next verse, and he cries out, I am the light of the world. I am the light of the world. Remember what John wrote later on in 1 John? God is light, and in him is no darkness at all. If you walk in the light as he is in the light, you have fellowship with one another, and the blood of Jesus Christ cleanses you from all sin. The repentant life, that in itself right there is the repentant life. To walk in the light as he is in light. To put on the new garments, the new life, the new nature. To let go of the old. To realize that the darkness is not his way. He is light. And if I walk in the light as he is in the light, I have fellowship with the others. I have fellowship with the body. I have fellowship with those of the faith. I have fellowship with Christ, with the Holy Spirit, with the Father above. I have fellowship. And then the blood of Jesus Christ is applied and cleanses me from all unrighteousness. Many people just say, I claim the blood. I claim the blood. And they pray over people as though, I claim the blood. But they refuse to walk in the light as he is in the light. And you call upon him in vain, thus breaking the commandment right there of using his name in vain. God Almighty is calling for you and I to live a life of loyalty and faithfulness, and to give up our adulterous ways of affections and personal affections, to sin no more, to whatever point that you have attained, press on. Move forward. Move that next thing. I don't do any of that stuff anymore like I used to. But still laden with timidity and still laden with personal effect, then that's got to go too, is it not? Yeah. It's not his Holy Spirit. Choosing our own way, going our own way. This age of mercy, when she saw him the second time, just for a moment, put yourself there seeing this taking place. Maybe you and I will see that taking place. Where he brings this, where's Rahab the harlot? Bring her here. Where's the adulterous woman? And in walks a saint. Where's Gary Cody? And in walks a saint. Put your name there. And this woman comes. And the last words she heard from Christ, sin no more. Personal, face to face, no one else there. Face to face, sin no more. Looking into his eyes, the very one who could have stoned her said this instead, and I leave it, sin no more. Wherever you're at, whatever personal laziness is robbing you, whatever personal affection is a thief in your life, whatever anxiety or depression is coming against you, whatever's causing a depression in your life, whatever causes you to doubt, whatever causes you to think to leave the very work of the Holy Spirit, cast it out. No. I want the cloud of witnesses. I want truth to come alive. I want this life to, I don't want to, I want to be holy as you are holy, to live as you live. And it's available right here. This isn't a, when I get to heaven, this all happens. This can happen right here, right now. This can happen for your children right here, right now. This will happen for the young ones right here, right now. This happens. Be holy as I am. Imitate God as dear children. Follow me as I follow Christ. This can happen right here, right now. My life is evidence that you don't have to stay stuck. I'm the evidence. This very life standing behind this pulpit is the evidence standing before you. That you don't have to be filled with adulterous minds and hearts. You don't have to have all of this envy or jealousy or pride or inferiority and weakness. I'm the very guy in front of you that is the evidence that God can bring you through.
Amen.
By simply saying, yes, Lord, and with all zeal and with all desire that you want to live a holy life, willing to forsake all so that you do not hear forsaken from Him.
Amen.
Forsook family, walked away, family walked away. Didn't go after, didn't chase, didn't look for. I'm going this way. Had people in this church who came, gave me hugs, loved me at my home, sat at my table. But when the cross came knocking on their door, turn away. Didn't chase them. Phone calls, sure. Meetings, try to, yep. But I'm going this way. Family come against. You don't parent this way. You're no pastor. You're no father. This is not the way you should be. You're too harsh. Well, then you raise your family the way you want, and I'll raise mine the way I want. In the end, we'll see the difference. Well, as a pastor, you should be this and you should be that. If I did what everybody told me to do, we'd be a mess. But I know what He has said. I know what He has taught me. I know who I am, and you know who. You must know the Holy Spirit. And He's not calling you for adulterous ways. He's calling you for holy ways.
Yes.
Holy unto the Lord. That's your new name. Holy unto the Lord. Holy unto the Lord. A holy love. A holy relationship. Holy men and women of God spoke as they were moved by the Holy Spirit. In Jesus' name. For the glory of God.
Amen.
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 Amen. Amen. May the Lord of glory keep you, guide you, uphold you, strengthen you, and keep you holy. But don't just think it's happening because you just want it to happen. You must pursue the holy love of God in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
God bless. Adam.